If you've followed me for a minute, you would probably be able to tell that I like old school stuff. I like stuff that was cracking way before my time, whether it's musicians, artists, actors, movies, criminal figures, what have you. There just seems to be something more romantic or mystique or original about different golden eras and golden ages of American history. And some dude clowned on me on my last Sade video saying I said the word authentic like 40 times, but authenticity is what I'm attracted to. And I like authentic things, and that's what I make videos on, different characters in American history that are seem to be authentic. And that's something I feel is lacking in modern society, whether it's music or movies or late night television. I'm not a fan of late night television. And I think it's a lot of fake and forced laughter that's involved, and it's just kind of a bunch of characters. But instead of clowning on current late night TV show hosts and what have you, I think I'm going to take the next 30 or so minutes dedicating my time talking about the greatest late night talk show host to ever exist, the gold standard, the greatest of all time, the real GOAT, the late and the great OG, Mr. Johnny Carson. Johnny Carson was born in Corning, Iowa in 1925. The second of three children, Carson and his family moved to a few small towns in Iowa before settling down in Norfolk, Nebraska when he was 8 years old. Johnny described his childhood, saying, quote, "I guess it was what you would call a normal upbringing, you know, the heart of the country. My folks were supportive in what I wanted to do." His childhood in Nebraska is where his knack for entertainment began. His first step into showbiz started at the age of 12 when he snagged a book of magic that he found at a friend's house. This instantly prompted him to purchase a mail-order magician's kit, where he began practicing magic tricks on friends and family members. Carson was known to never leave the house without a deck of cards, constantly asking family members to pick a card, any card. Johnny's mother even sewed a cape for him, where he developed the moniker The Great Carsoni and performed his first magic show at the age of 14, which earned him a whopping $3. Even though he was quoted as saying his folks were supportive in his entertainment endeavors, it's documented that his mother, Ruth Carson, ran an extremely strict household compared to, quote, "a captain of a warship," with Johnny always seeking approval from her, in which he rarely received. He and his mother had a subpar relationship since he was a young boy, and when she died in 1985, Johnny did not attend her funeral and was even quoted as saying, "the wicked witch is finally dead." It is documented, however, that after she died, there was a box of clippings of Carson's achievements in magazines and newspapers that were found in her closet, and Johnny kept that same box in his own closet until he died. From a young age, Johnny felt the need to entertain, because he felt in control. If he wasn't entertaining, even in front of a small crowd of family members, he was known to be very quiet and awkward and almost antisocial.
You considered then a very shy, introverted kid?
Yeah, I think so. I went back and looked at my high school annual the other day. And the word conceit I'd see once in a while or stuck up. People didn't understand the shyness. And I think a lot of times when they see people that they think are aloof,
yeah,
all words that have been attributed to me at one time or another, or cool.
Still.
Yeah, or reserved, are really a basic shyness.
Mm-hmm.
An uncomfortableness sometimes around large groups of people. And so you kind of retreat. I think one of the reasons I took up magic as a kid was the fact that it gave me a chance to get out in front of people and kind of subordinate your own personality and become somebody else, become a magician.
Carson would perform his magic shows at local churches, high schools, and county fairs to make a quick buck. And after graduating high school, he joined the United States Navy in 1943 and he boarded the USS Pennsylvania as a junior officer in the infantry regiment. Here he earned a 15-0 boxing record and entertained his Navy buddies by using his ventriloquist dummy. His ship was en route to a combat zone, but before arrival, the war had ended. Carson noted that his high point in his military career was when he performed a magic trick for James V. Forrestal, the U.S. Secretary of the Navy. He realized if he could amuse someone as cranky as Forrestal, he could amuse anybody. After his military service, he attended the University of Nebraska-Lincoln, where he majored in journalism, continuing to perform magic shows and now charging $25 an appearance. He initially wanted to become a comedy writer, but switched his major to speech and drama in hopes to become a radio performer. His college thesis was titled How to Write Comedy for Radio, where he provided voiceovers of recorded comedy skits from popular shows at the time, and he explained the different comedic techniques that were used. This project allowed him to graduate college in 3 years. His broadcasting career started in 1950 when he took a job at WOW Radio and Television in Omaha. To make a little extra money, Carson served as the master of ceremonies at local churches and weddings. In 1951, through connections that he made in Nebraska, he packed his bags and he moved to Los Angeles, where he was hired as a radio announcer at KNTX LA. This turned into a bigger opportunity as he became the host of his own show, Carson's Cellar, which aired on Sunday afternoons. This gained him a small cult following, and among these new fans of his was none other than the legendary comedian Red Skelton. Skelton was impressed with Carson and hired him as a supporting writer for his own CBS show. The two became closely acquainted, which blossomed Carson's soon-to-be legendary career. A major turning point took place in 1954 when Skelton accidentally knocked himself out during a rehearsal an hour before the live taping was set to begin. Carson was asked to fill in for him, and his appearance ended up being a success, which got Jack Benny's attention. Benny invited Carson onto the Jack Benny program and told him he was confident that Carson would end up becoming a successful comedian. It's cool to think that, as a kid, Johnny Carson was very influenced by Jack Benny and would listen to him on the radio as a kid, and then years down the line ends up working with him and becoming close friends, and ends up getting Jack Benny to be a guest on Johnny Carson's own show. So I guess the message is don't give up, kids, or follow your dreams. Carson hosted a variety of shows, some relatively successful and some failures, such as the Johnny Carson Show. After the Carson Show crashed, he bounced to New York to host the show Who Do You Trust from 1957 to 1962. It was here where he met his future longtime sidekick, Ed McMahon. Now this is where the fun begins. Late night television was still new and pretty experimental at the time. Steve Allen was the first host, with his version being aired from 1954 to 57. The legendary Jack Parr replaced him and hosted for 5 years. Jack Parr left the show on March 30th, 1962, citing the fact that he could no longer handle the load of putting on an hour and 45-minute show a night, 5 nights a week. Over the course of its run, Parr was given more time off so that Mondays featured a guest host and all Friday shows were Best of Parr repeats, giving Parr only 3 nights of material to fill. To fulfill the rest of his NBC contract after leaving Tonight, Parr hosted a primetime variety series, The Jack Parr Program, and aired weekly on Friday nights through 1965. But with Parr's departure, NBC hit up Carson to become the new host. Oddly enough, Johnny initially declined the offer. In an interview, he stated, "I turned The Tonight Show down the first time it was offered to me because Who Do You Trust was very comfortable and quite easy. My first reaction was, why do you need that kind of trouble? Then they came back 3 weeks later and I said, if you're really going to take a shot at it, if you really want to entertain, you ought to grab for all the marbles or get out of the business. The more I thought about it, the more I became convinced that Tonight was the only network show where I could do the nutty, experimental, low-key thing that I liked best." Johnny, bringing along his sidekick, Ed McMahon, took the job, and The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson began, christening the most prolific and influential late-night television show to ever exist. Each show would open up with Ed McMahon introducing Johnny, with Doc Severinsen and The Tonight Show band's theme song playing. Carson would open up with a brief monologue where he would deliver jokes about current events, setting the tone for the show. This was followed by a combination of celebrity interviews, musical performances, and comic sketches. Carson was known for his impeccable comic timing and his ability to allow guests to shine, making the show not only a platform for humor, but also a significant stage for musical and comedic talent. Unlike the current late-night show hosts, Johnny never interrupted his guests. The conversations were so casual and organic, but nothing short of entertaining, and there was never really a political agenda involved. Obviously, I wasn't around when Johnny Carson was doing his thing, but it's really interesting to all these shows and clips I've seen on YouTube, and I've been watching him for years. It all just seems pretty, I'll say it, authentic, and the conversations are very, like, real, and there are even some awkward moments because there's no forced fake laughter like you see today.
So it's hard to formulate those thoughts, but no, the thing is, it's weird.
The roster of guests over the 30 years the show was on the air was like one giant all-star team. Ronald Reagan, Frank Sinatra, Betty White, Richard Pryor, Muhammad Ali, Marlon Brando, George Carlin, George Foreman, Jonathan Winters, and of course, Don Rickles.
And you dumb people come to see me, I am wealthy. I am Johnny Carson. I am a little farm boy that became a millionaire, and you people are dumb. And I got a beautiful wife and a big house, and little Timmy and three sons. There's a wolf in the yard.
My personal favorite guest on the show was probably Robin Williams, because you can't really interview Robin Williams. You kind of just have to let him do his thing and let him run wild. And that's exactly what Johnny would do. And those interviews for sure made me laugh the hardest. And it seems like that's the hardest Johnny ever laughed, was at the Robin Williams interviews for sure.
I'd be walking around. It's Christmas time in San Francisco. There's a guy dressed up as Sado Claus. You better watch out. You better not count down. Santa Claus now. That's wild. Oh,
Johnny never tried to take the attention off whoever he was interviewing. He let whatever happened, happen. Another thing to note is that he very rarely interacted with the guests backstage before the show. He wanted the conversations to be as candid as possible, making it so special. The beginning stint of the show was filmed at 30 Rockefeller Plaza in New York, then moved to Burbank, California in 1972 due to its close proximity to celebrities. By the mid-1970s, The Tonight Show was the most profitable television show to exist, making NBC $60 million a year. In 2024, that would equate to $230 million a year. At one point, it was seen by 15 million people on a nightly basis. The skits, the guests, and of course the host, glued people to their TV screens across the country. Watching the show from your home was one thing, but to be a guest on the show either meant you were already a prominent figure or you got invited on as a test to let America know if you had it or not. Actor Robert Blake once recalled that being interviewed by Johnny on The Tonight Show was like facing the Death Squad or Broadway on opening night. If you messed up, there was no going back and you were subject to destroying your career before it even started, but the reward was so high if you made a good first appearance that most people were willing to take that risk. Being on the show launched a vast number of careers into eventual A-list stardom. Drew Carey, Ellen DeGeneres, Eddie Murphy, Louis Anderson, and Jerry Seinfeld are just some of the few that got their big break just by performing on the show. If Johnny gave you a wink or a head nod, that meant you did good. But if he called you over to sit down on the couch for a quick interview after your performance, you could officially say you made it.
That's the kind of food just marches right down your throat, you know? Follow me, boys. We're going to the heart.
He goes like this. And I go, who, me? And he goes, yeah, you. And I'm like, oh, no, nobody gets called over for the Tonight Show. That's a big thing. It's like a religious experience. And then after that, my career was made.
You're funny as hell.
Thanks. I appreciate that.
You
thank
really you are. Are.
Thanks.
You too.
Yeah. So.
Jerry Seinfeld, reminiscing on his first appearance on The Tonight Show and being called to sit on the couch, said, "This is some kind of magic place. There's just not that many moments in life that are that definitive of a before and after in life. Before, you're wanting to become a comedian, and after, you are one." Bear with me now, but appearing on The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson back in those days, you can equate that with appearing on the Joe Rogan Experience in current times, because both platforms were like the biggest at the time. Or Johnny Carson was the biggest at the time for shows, and Joe Rogan is the biggest for podcasts. It's the most popular podcast for years now, and that was the biggest show on television for years. So if you were to appear on The Tonight Show back then, it's like the same thing. If you appeared on Joe Rogan, your career is just going to skyrocket overnight. It's just, that's how much power and influence these people have. Especially nowadays, there's so much political discourse that's plugged into any sort of mainstream media. Carson always avoided such topics because he, as an entertainer, believed that he was there to entertain. He said, "I'm so old-fashioned, I was taught that it's not polite to discuss religion, politics, or money. Now that leaves out three of the biggest things people talk about, so you talk about other things." Jay Leno once told an interviewer, "You never knew Johnny's politics. He would come out and equally make fun of everybody." Carson recognized that he wasn't on TV to sway elections or change the audience's minds about current events. And even though it was his idea to move the show to Los Angeles to have easier access to get celebrities on the show, he interviewed all types of people. From talking to a 97-year-old farmer.
Somebody said you have a lady friend that you occasionally visit here on California.
Oh gosh, I visit her more than occasionally.
to being punched by a baboon, anything could happen on The Tonight Show. After 17 years of hosting, Carson was tired and he threatened to leave. But in 1980, he negotiated a 3-year deal which ended up being the most lucrative in the history of entertainment to date. It earned him an annual salary of $25 million, 15 weeks off, and reduced the show time from 90 to 60 minutes. He also became the producer and the owner of the show, along with owning the hour of airtime after the show that was filled by David Letterman, in which Carson, of course, approved. As the 1980s progressed, Johnny Carson's position as the undisputed king of late-night television was firmly established, yet the landscape around him was beginning to change. The emergence of new talents and competing shows, most notably David Letterman's Late Night, which aired immediately after The Tonight Show, began to shift the dynamics within the network and among viewing audiences. This period marked not just a continuation of Carson's success, but also set the stage for his eventual departure. Carson's influence during this period remained significant. His monologues continued to reflect and shape public discourse, gently poking fun at certain political upheaval and cultural shifts of the time. His ability to engage with audience and guests with genuine charm and wit remained unchanged, making The Tonight Show the still go-to spot for both entertainment and a sense of national community. Behind the scenes, however, Johnny was preparing for his next phase. He became more private, and rumors of retirement began to circulate, creating a buzz about potential successors. By the early 1990s, the question of when Carson would retire became a frequent topic of media speculation. In 91, he stunned his audience and the entertainment world by announcing his retirement during his anniversary show, stating, simply, "Next year, I'm gonna be retiring." This announcement was met with an outpouring of tributes and reflections of his nearly 3 decades at the helm of The Tonight Show. His departure marked the end of an era for American television. Carson had not only shaped the late-night landscape, but had also become a beloved cultural icon whose influence would endure well beyond his years on the air. His final show aired in May of 1992, a very bittersweet goodbye to the best to ever do it. The show's finale highlighted all the entertaining moments during his reign dating back to his start back in 1962. With his final goodbye and one last golf swing aimed at the band, Carson walked off the Tonight Show stage for the very last time.
You people watching, I can only tell you that it has been an honor and a privilege to come into your homes all these years and entertain you. And I hope when I find something that I want to do and I think you will like and come back that you'll be as gracious inviting me into your home as you have been. I bid you a very heartfelt good night.
In his last appearance on television, he was on Letterman in 1994, where he appeared for only a few minutes, not saying a single word, and getting one of the longest standing ovations in entertainment history. But behind the scenes, who really was Johnny Carson? Being one of the most prominent figures in American history, you would think that his onstage persona, success, and influence would parallel his personal life. But it was the exact opposite. Like I mentioned earlier, Carson was extremely shy off screen. He was a recluse. When the cameras were off, he was almost invisible.
I always sense that somehow Carson is on guard, wary.
Mm-hmm.
You are?
Sure.
Why?
I like to keep certain things private. I probably do put up a barrier until I get to know people.
It's very hard for him to express his feelings to people, really only those he trusts a lot.
Andrew Nichols, the show's head writer from 88 to 92, said, "He was a classic introvert, the kind of person who's recharged by being alone and depleted by being among people. He'd get into his car with a palpable sense of relief after a show like, that was good, now I'd like to be alone in the dark listening to jazz. He didn't socialize much, he saved his energy for performance." Dick Cavett, another legendary talk show host back in those days, explained, "I felt sorry for Johnny in the fact that he was so socially uncomfortable. I've hardly ever met anybody who had as hard as a time as he did. On stage, Johnny had charisma, quick wit, and he seemed like a nice enough fella, but he was a much different person off camera." Many of his own family members explained that they themselves didn't even really know who he was. Documentary filmmaker Peter Jones was persistent in making a documentary about Carson. Over the course of 15 years, Jones sent Carson dozens of letters, essentially begging him for permission to make a film on his life. As expected, Jones never heard back until 15 years passed and Carson unexpectedly called Jones saying, "You write a damn fine letter, Peter, but I don't have anything else to say." Even though he kept his private life extremely private, one thing he wasn't able to hide was his love life, meaning he was married 4 times and divorced 3 and had to pay millions in alimony. His broken marriages were frequent subjects to jokes throughout The Tonight Show. Carson married his first wife, Jody Wolcott, in 1948. The Collard sweethearts had 3 sons together, in which he never had a good relationship with. In 1970, he told his lawyer, Henry Bushkin, "I'm a shit. I have 3 kids with my first wife and I don't see any of them. I can't quit smoking and I get drunk every night and I chase all the I can get. Make sure you understand this." He said it, not me. His first marriage, along with his others, was plagued with infidelity and toxicity. In 1959, Jody, his once college sweetheart, filed for divorce. And in 1963, only a few months after their divorce was finalized, Johnny married his second wife, Joanne. But like his previous marriage, the relationship was filled with more infidelity and a lot of fighting. The marriage came to an end when Johnny suspected Joanne of having an affair with football player Frank Gifford. Carson, along with 3 other men, including his newly hired 27-year-old lawyer Henry Bushkin, broke into Joanne's secret apartment to collect evidence to prove that she actually was cheating on him. According to Bushkin's book, titled Johnny Carson, which I highly recommend, the 4 men did find substantial evidence of an affair. Bushkin recalls seeing Johnny Carson in the corner of the apartment crying, a rare sight for anyone to see. He also noted seeing a .38 revolver in Carson's waistband. Decades later, both Joanne and Gifford denied having an affair, so who really knows what's true? In 1972, they divorced, and Joanne received $500,000 in settlements and $35,000 a month for 64 months in alimony payments. Again, he got married shortly after his second divorce to Joanna Holland. Bushkin advised Carson to sign a prenup, but he refused, stating, "I love her, and I'll be with her forever." But of course, the trend continued and the couple divorced in 1983. With 3 divorces under his belt and the 3rd making major headlines, many of his friends and other celebrities would often tease him about his breakups.
That's pretty young to get married.
Yeah, it was a dumb move.
Yeah, and this didn't work out?
No, I know.
Was that when you were the preacher?
Strange things to you, but it didn't
work out. Yeah, I know,
yeah. I feel like I'm sitting with Yoda.
After the divorce, Joanna received a $20 million settlement. His final marriage to Alexis Moss from 1987 up until his death in 2005 was Johnny's longest. Family and close friends noted that his 4th marriage seemed to be the happiest. I'm skimming over these marriages and his love life because, I know I'm trying to make a documentary here, but it's kind of hard for me to speak on another man's love life and his wives and their situations. You don't know unless you were there kind of thing. There is a lot of information about them. Because there's 4 of them, and they were public record, obviously, with a famous person like Johnny Carson. But if you wanted to do more research, you can. There's a lot more involved, but I think the one thing I got out of it was the amount of money that man had to pay, and he kept getting married anyways. Carson's private life was obviously very private. Besides playing tennis, or playing the drums, or enjoying smoking a cigarette, or 3, not much is completely known about his daily habits or endeavors. He was never really close with his 3 sons, a situation he always had deep remorse for. His son Rick Carson attempted to follow his father's footsteps in many different ways. He enlisted in the Navy, just like his father, which ended up being a disaster after he developed a horrible drinking problem and he had to be discharged and enter treatment. He was known to be mentally unstable. He also tried to get into the television world, working as a production assistant on Tom Snyder's show Tomorrow. But his son Rick eventually became a photographer, but in June of 91, Rick Carson was driving alongside Kaya Coast Drive, a service road that runs alongside California's Highway 1 near the Pacific Ocean, when his car went over the edge of the road and fell down an embankment. Carson was thrown from the car where he died of his injuries. Johnny's son was only 39 years when he died. In his grief, his father took 4 weeks off from his TV show after the accident. His first TV appearance after his son's death, Johnny shared photos of Rick and photos taken by his son with the viewers. He spoke of his son, saying, "When Rick was around, you wanted to smile. He had a laugh that was contagious as could be. He tried so darn hard to please," according to Esquire magazine. Carson's private life stayed almost completely private until Henry Bushkin's book on The Tonight Show host came out in 2015. The stories and personal experiences that Bushkin had with Carson weren't all roses and daisies. The book painted Johnny in a different light than what his on-screen persona was. He was an incredibly complex man, Bushkin wrote. One moment he's gracious, funny, and generous, and the next, curt, aloof, and cold-hearted. But behind his charismatic on-screen persona and his off-screen isolated and sometimes cold-hearted personality, Carson was deeply committed to philanthropy, often contributing quietly and without seeking any public recognition. His donations spanned various fields including education, health, and the arts. His efforts were particularly impactful in the home state of Nebraska. He donated millions to the University of Nebraska scholarship programs, which have supported countless students in achieving their educational goals. Beyond education, he contributed significantly to the construction of the Johnny Carson Theater in Norfolk, Nebraska, fostering the arts in a community close to his roots. Even after his passing, Carson's legacy of charity continued through substantial bequests from his estate, highlighting a lifetime commitment to giving back to the community. Johnny had been giving the Johnny Carson Foundation annual gifts of $1 to $2 million. Upon his death, the foundation was told that it was the beneficiary of a trust from Johnny's estate. The value of the trust remained a secret for 5 years until his lawyers were required to disclose the assets in an IRS tax return. On August 30, 2010, the Carson Foundation discovered that the value of their trust fund was worth an astonishing $156 million. Just days before Carson's death, it was revealed that the retired King of Late Night still kept up with current events and late night TV, and that he occasionally sent jokes to Letterman. Letterman would then use these jokes in the monologue of his show, which Carson apparently got a big kick out of. On January 22, 2005, Johnny Carson unfortunately passed away in a Los Angeles hospital after a 3-year battle with emphysema. With countless tributes from celebrities across the world, and even the president at the time, it was clear that Carson's legacy was ginormous, and he touched the lives of billions. For more than 30 years, The Tonight Show with Johnny Carson was a staple in family living rooms across the country. The gold standard for late night television, nobody will ever come close to the actual greatest of all time. There's so much more you can go off on, and there's so much, obviously, a 30-year time span of Johnny Carson. The Tonight Show is a long time. But the one thing I will say is Carson was very, very good, besides his marriages, at keeping his private life private. He's like, some celebrities want to be seen in the limelight or be out and about, but he genuinely like did not want to be around people. The book that I'm reading from his lawyer pretty much explains that. But the way I see it is Henry Bushkin, his lawyer that wrote this biography that came out in 2015, pretty much just heightened and brought a bunch of these Carson stories and personality traits to the surface, and I don't think that's something that Carson would want. I guess you have to take the book at face value. You can believe it or not. I mean, I believe the stories that his lawyer is writing about, I believe they're true. I just think that, I don't know, if you wanted to keep your private life private, and he was really good at it, and then after his death, all these different quirks about him. Apparently he was a nasty drunk, a very, very mean drunk, serial womanizer, and could be very rude to many different people. That's just what the book says, and that's what kind of came out after he published it. But at the end of the day, he seemed like a good guy, and he did a lot, and he was a legendary figure in American television, and he still is today. His YouTube clips of the old Johnny Carson clips still get huge amount of views today, and I would rather watch them than anything currently on late night right now. So, and if anyone out there is watching that was around when Johnny Carson and late night show with Johnny Carson was live and going on, I would love to hear stories about you watching him. What was your traditions? Did you watch him with family, your family members? Any good memories about certain guests or specific shows, or I just like listening to people that were around when these things that I talk about were current and live. So I would love to hear from anybody that has any, personal experiences of watching Johnny Carson back in the day. And rest in peace to the greatest of all time. People always say that the GOAT, this person's the GOAT, this person's a legend. But in this situation, late night television show host, crown of being the GOAT goes to Mr. Johnny Carson.